There is a technique to kind of bring back your focus as an audience right now, because right now everyone is probably like, oh, I had this conversation with this guy, and I should not forget to take something else or whatever. So the technique to bring back the focus in the room is actually clapping. So give a warm round of applause for Ilona right now. Before I invite her to start her talk, I just want to mention how we actually found her. So this is actually not her first time in Sofia. She spoke at PartialConf, which is a Ruby conference here. Our friends Gennady and Vestilia are organizing it. They also helped us with organizational stuff, advice, and so on. So I guess Bulgarian audience is pretty good. That's why she's coming back. So thank you very much, and the stage is yours. Thanks.
My name is Simona. I'm a front-end software engineer at Zenjob in Berlin, and today my talk is about conversational setup with chatbot-like experience with React and Redux. But before starting, I want to highlight that actually I am not a chatbot expert, and I just tried to create and design the conversational experience as a chatbot for a setup form. Why I decided to do that? Because I have some kind of the motivation. A year ago, I was looking for a new job. So, and during the interview process, during the technical interview, I got testing tasks, and it was not only about the front-end part, it was also about the user experience stuff. And my interviewers actually asked me, think out of the box, because the test task it was about creating some sign-up form that consisted of 10 or 12 questions, so around that, and you understand, so there are different approaches how to do that. So, and then I thought about so this form, and I think, maybe perhaps it would be better to try to create a chatbot, because first of all, it's interesting, and it's you, and it's hype. So, then I started looking for some information on the internet, how I can do that actually, so what approaches people apply for that, so what the techniques are around. And then I found and applied 5 rules, so during the creating a user experience, and also I implemented it, and today I'm going to speak about that. So let's start from the rule. The first rule is actually to understand the goal of the chatbot. So I also evaluated the reason why we actually need a chatbot. So the reason was because I had a form with many input fields, and I said maybe to collect information in this way, so during the conversation between chatbot and the user would be a better approach to get information from the user. So, and my chatbot serves a certain purpose, it's enough the user for their product. The next rule is creating conversational user experience. So here I mean sometimes users are not convinced, so they have some concerns about the product. And chatbot actually can help to convince the user to sign up. How? Chatbot can actually to provide some information about the product. So what's the benefit the user will get if the user sign up for this product? What user will expect from the product? And what's the value the user will get at the end? The third is actually to give a personality to the chatbot. So here, I mean, when we are chatting with someone, we want to chat not the bot, we want to chat, some person. So in this case, it's a good approach to make conversation more personalized. For that, you can also get fitting name, avatar, animated emotions, and voice to a chatbot. So, for example, my chatbot has avatar and the voice. First, it's a behavior, how the chatbot will reply on the user. The next step is actually for know the user responses. So here, I mean, it would be easier and better for the user if, for example, the chatbot would predict the user responses. In my version of chatbot, I did it through the answer options buttons. So, for example, the chatbot asks the user the question and also provides some options buttons with the answer. So, in this case, the user just needs to click on the most suitable answer and proceed to the next question. Last but not least, it's very important also to preview all the data for the user, because actually the user should know what the data he's going to submit for the sign up. So, and yes, let's move to the next slide. So here I want to show you how actually my chatbot looks like. So here there are desktop view and there is a mobile view. Today I'm going to present desktop view. So you see the desktop view, the chatbot is located on the right side of the screen. So it started from the initial message. So for example, greetings, so welcome chatbot. And then the chatbot asking so how the chatbot can help the user. So just here is the overall conversation. So actually my chatbot is a simple state machine. So we have started from the initial state, so current state is a welcome state, is greeting. Then if the user is already convinced he wants to sign up with the product, then he goes to call to action and the user starting so enter their data. Then chatbot will allows user to preview this data and then the user will confirm it and it's done. So sign up is finished. Otherwise, if the user is not convinced for sign up, the user will provide some details and explain what the benefits of this and advantages of this product. So in this case, the user can understand more about the product. How actually data management for my chatbot? Actually, all data is stored in the nested JSON object and in the state of the chatbot reducer. And why I decided actually to use this approach? The thing is, I guess, is easier. So the reason is, of course, it's easy to change the data without any coding. It could be done, for example, through content and marketing system, and even by non-programmer person. Let's have a look closer to the data object. So here you see, is it here? So, current state field is actually the current state of the application is in now. Fields collect all user responses during the conversation. History is array of the old messages that we have during the conversation with chatbot and the user, so it's stored here. Sets is the array of the states. Each set has IDs and defined of the state. Message and size is actually it's alleged data, it's below, it's alleged data for the state. Transitions is the next possible moves from the current state to the next state, and each transition has triggers, for example, delay, or for example, button. So it's specific user interaction, for example, that will be trigger the transition and change to the next state. So, and here, transition is the key for the conversational experience. Why? So first of all, every transition has a next state, next set field that reference to the ID of the state that will be active the next after the transition. And every transition depends on the user action. So, I mean, here the user, for example, just confirmed the answer or clicking on the button answer, or for example, during the enter button. So, the next, I want to explain actually how I have implemented that React and Redux. As you got the idea, so it works by triggering the proper transition when certain user interactions happen. When I'm working with React and Redux, I'm always starting with writing the action first. So you see here, so the first action is called make transition. So, this action will happen after processing after the user request, and will be dispatching to the reducer. So here, this also, we are passing here the next state. So here you see actually how the reducer is handled this this actually action. The reducer will replace the current state with the next state and send the previous state into the history. In the next step, I want to show you actually how we are going to render all the messages. So here we have message component. Message component, so in this case, it renders all the current message, so with the user responses. And also this previous state is the state of the previous, it actually consists of the previous messages in the chatbot. It also renders through the message component. The next, now I want to show you how actually the message component is implemented. So here you see the two conditions, if conditions. So the first one is relevant at the moment because it's because I have created this for the last step when we need to preview all this, all the data that the user entered then. So it's relevant now. But the next, this condition, if condition, actually help to distinguish between the two sides of the conversation. So for example, it could be either user or the chatbot. So if the user or the chatbot, then the, in this case we are going to render here the corresponding message with the correct styling for that. Yes, and another step. So if, as soon as we started to ask the user to enter the data, so in this case we need also to bind the data into the our conversation. For that, I have created a new type of the transition. So here is called input. And for example, you see is the line of name because I am asking for the name of the user, and another step. How I can actually to render this name for the next message. So instead of my name is dollar name dollar, should be here the name. And of course the solution is interpolation technique. And I implemented that in the render message function. So here you see the implementation of this function. So it sets two parameters, two arguments, message and field. And then I'm going to iterate over all fields and replace the corresponding pattern with the value of the field. As I mentioned before, field is the values that user entered, and then we return new message with a user response. Last but not least, actually, as soon as we started to ask the user to enter the data, the next step we need to update the field and update the input. On change. So that's why we need another action that's called update field. Also these two arguments, field and value. So field is actually is the key of the input and value is the value provided by the user. So as I come back. So at the end we have only two dispatching actions. So and it's really nice. So here is the full implementation of the reducer. So and here we see how we are going to handle update field. So it's return. So in this case, the user will update the corresponding field with the provided value from the user. Yes. And So and now we have two ways how actually we can collect the data from the user. So the first one is on click button. So in this case, so the user just use the offered answer from the chatbot, and another way is the user will enter the data that the chatbot would ask the user to enter. So after you receive all the data, so now it's time actually to preview all the data for the user. So the user sees what they have entered before. And if they agree with that, they will proceed to the, they will just proceed to sign up. So, for this, to implement that, actually I have created another, for the last state, I have added a new field, so it's called component, with a confirmed sign up component value. So why I did it actually? Because so the message component that we used before, it will not fit to this case because message component can render only one line message, and we need actually now to render all fields that user have entered before. So we are out of fields. Here is implementation of the confirmed sign up component. So as you see, the browser here is the fields. Fields is all user responses, and now from the fields is the object. And from this object, we actually get the name of the user. We get actually the purpose of what the user wanted to sign up for this product. So email of the user and other information about the subscription. If the user is, would like to subscribe for this product, for the newsletters, or I don't know, for some other things. Yes, and the next step, I also added a new transition, I'm going to come back. So it's submit, because now, because I need to finish that. And now, if the user is already so agreed with that and ready to press its sign up, just click on the submit button. And now I'm going to console log the message so we successfully signed up and also render all fields the user have entered during the conversation. Just console log also these fields. Why I actually do that? Because I don't have a proper backend for that. So, but I want that you show the results that it works. Yes, now it's demo time. Thank you very much. Oh, but I don't see this here. So, and see how it works now. So, here we are started. So, the chat was greeting us and asking, so, we are helping some explaining what the purpose of the product, for example, it's an app for productivity. So I don't know. So and so I'm not convinced to sign up for this web application. So and I'm just asking for more details. So then chatbot explain me so what I expect from the product. So for example, so either I want to have more time for myself or get more things done or do same with the less time or effort. So I decided, for example, I want to get my things done. So here I just put some code, but actually it would be like some kind of the explanation, some kind of the bribe. So that's why you need to use our product because it will help you. And so and chatbot asked against them. So are you ready to try? And said, no, I'm still not convinced. Then chatbot asked me again. So maybe you would like to do something else, and just okay, maybe to do same with the less time for effort. Then we just repeat this kind of the loop, and then the bot asked me, so are you ready to give a try? And I said, yes, I am ready. Then finally, then the bot asked about my name. Okay, Alice, I don't know. So now usually you see the interpolation technique and now the Alice. So we are personalizing this conversation and then we'll just ask Alice, what do you want to learn it for? So I'm decided, okay, I want to learn for personal life and work for both. So then chatbot asked me, so where they could send some tips or tricks, so ask for my email. So, and here I'm to send an email. But also so, render my email, that's like the confirmation, send thanks. So the chat will ask me if I'm interested to subscribe. Some date or maybe newsletter. I said, okay, yes. So in the end, actually, chatbot is preview all the data that I entered before. So, and again, I said it's okay. So I'm going to go for it. I'm going for it. I inspect it. I'm going to, where is power? I just want to show the result. Oh, finally, thank you. So it's okay, it's the data that I entered before. okay, so that's it. Let's come to the keynote. Play it. Yeah, and thank you. Also found some of the codes which are going to spawn things and it's here on GitHub.
Yeah. So guys, now it's time for the panel again. You know the format, so Kras is recording a podcast, by the way. Have you heard about a podcast? If you have, raise your hand. All right.
Okay, we managed to mirror the screen. So I saw that you showed us a picture of the layout first. Then you showed us, a diagram with the state machine, and then into the implementation. Is this the way of how you usually develop apps? Like you start with the design somehow, they go to the app flow, and then continue with the implementation.
Actually, I prefer to divide a big problem into small steps.
Okay.
Yes, and as I mentioned before, so my technical task at the moment, it was not only about the front end, it was also about the user experience. Yes, and about the different ways how it could be implemented. And usually I'm doing like that. And so I try just to understand what approach I'm going to use for that. I understand, I built a state machine. And then, of course, during this implementation, I just add some steps, so I'm figuring out so how it will work or how it would be better to present. Yes, during this implementation, I, of course, add some things to improve the design and implementation in general. So it was like that.
I really like that it's like the way you designed that is very like reusable, and I can see that you might use it in some other situation. Have you thought about like using this exact like flow for other places in the applications you're working on?
Actually, yes, it could be, but so now current so at work we don't do that. But the idea, so actually we teamed it and the dev team really liked it. Maybe in the future we are going to do that. For my side project, so I also keep in mind that I can do that, but it depends on the project, of course.
Did you actually were doing like A/B testing from your like the old flow to the new flow?
No. So it was like that for the testing task. So I just wanted to try to implement that idea. So because it's not going to the production in general. So and yes, I like it to do. And I also like it that other people like it to see this result.
A little bit about Redux. Do you remember how you start actually writing the implementation, the application? Like, did you start from the components or did you start from the actions? Because for myself, for example, I prefer to start from the sketching the actions in my app, then continue with the reducer, for example. But some of my colleagues, they prefer to do the UI first and then continue with the logic to wire and stuff. And so what is your approach of building that?
I also prefer starting with React and Redux. I also prefer to you start with the actions, so I'm going to dispatch to the reducer. But as I remember, so the first things actually I did, I implemented the first trigger, it was delay. I mean, just to see that message actually just changes, but it was not about the action, so the next action is actually that it changed to the next state, so to the next message. Yes, most like that.
The topic about state machine, I have some history with it, and now I think that almost everything in the front-end development could be actually represented in the state machine. Do you use this concept about state machines in your daily job outside of this app, for example? Well, because every time when you have to deal with some kind of state, you're basically building a state machine.
Actually, yes, I can say that. I also apply this approach at work, so because we are working with a huge form, and the form consists of different questions, different question pages, so that's why it's really nice, so depending on the user answer, so it will be going to the different kinds of the pages or the questions.
Do you have to explain this to your colleagues, like the concept about state machines? Are they adopting the idea of using a state machine sort? Here's where my question is coming from. When I share this idea with my colleagues that we're actually building state machines every time, we have to use a tool for this because we have tools for state machines. You don't have to implement it every time. There are tools where you can just describe your states and there is some API for switching from state one state to another. And they weren't really keen to that kind of approach. So did you try to kind of bring this knowledge to your colleagues?
The thing is actually a decision we take some at work. We are doing that together. So someone would just offer this, have this solution, but then it always discussed, I mean, in the team. So, and this, they also thought it's a nice idea to try it and to apply for the project because of the specific of our project, I would like to say that I'm working on.
One thing we would like to incorporate into the forum is if anybody from the audience actually have a question, you can also raise your hand and we would ask it for you. Actually, you would sort of ask the microphone. Any questions? Like, I know Andrew had one. You shy?
I found it really interesting. I never thought about it this, before. I was just wondering if you had need to set a password in this world, like if it's like a sign up, would you like send an email and then the password is like generated or you think you could also have in the flow an input just to set the password for the user?
I guess I also can use it the same form and just create a new state that will also be the input password. So also to add some validation for that. So and so to the work, I guess.
Questions anymore?
It's really interesting, and in creation what Elizabeth said about the password, don't you think that from a security perspective, maybe it really depends on in what product you're going to incorporate it, because maybe for some products it will be okay to do it in the flow, but for other passwords it will be, for other products, I'm sorry, it will be really better if you do it via email.
Yeah, maybe it depends on the product completely, can agree. So, but so it was like the example of a doing. We are not doing this at work. I mean, this chatbot conversational experience approach. But in general, it could be also done and used.
What was the reasoning behind calling the gate Redux and not just using React state the state of a React component?
So actually, I'm a React developer, I would like to say, and also applied for the position where the library we are using for the project also React and Redux. So I guess it will be nice to use the same tech stack and do this testing task that is React and Redux.
Have you thought about like how you're going to like test that with like automated tests? Would you just do like full feature tests, like browser clicking around? Are you going to just test the components or the Redux state?
So actually, I don't think about that because as you see, we have only React and Redux, so we don't have any asynchronous actions. So that's why I don't know if it depends on what we are going to do with that, and if you need, of course, to cover. Integration this test, that's what it's
So let's thank you for the talk.